Welcome back, everyone. Today we're going to talk about chord symbols for inversions through the use of slash chords, chord voicings, voices, doubled chord factors, and a few typical voicings for triads and seventh chords. Let's get started. It's possible to notate inversions with chord symbols through the use of slash chords. Slash chords are notated with a forward slash mark where the notation to the left of the slash mark indicates the chord to be played, while the notation to the right of the slash mark indicates the lowest note, which is usually a chord factor. On piano, it is often the case that the chord is played with the right hand while the single low note is played with the left hand, although sometimes the low note is played in octaves. These examples demonstrate the first inversion, second inversion, and third inversion respectively. Notice the root position is not notated with a slash chord since it has the root as the lowest note by default and would be redundant notation. Slash chords are typically employed to indicate an inversion, but not always. These examples demonstrate slash chords where the notation to the right of the slash mark is not a chord factor. Be careful to indicate slash chords with a forward slash mark and not a horizontal slash mark since a horizontal slash mark indicates a polychord, which will be covered in a later episode. A chord voicing is simply any unique way of arranging the chord factors of a chord in various octaves through octave displacement. Each note in a chord is commonly referred to as a voice, much in the way you might refer to each note in a chord from a choral score as a voice. The common arrangement of the voices would be an SATB arrangement, where the voices are named soprano, alto, tenor, and bass voices, respectively, from the highest voice to the lowest voice. There are many different voicings for any type of chord, and to try to list them all is beyond the scope of this episode. What is important to know is 1. The root of the chord is usually the lowest note since it is the foundation that helps define the quality and character of the chord. This is not always the case, however. Exceptions would be intentional inversions where, for example, the third of the chord is the lowest voice is actually the desired sound, or leaving the root of the chord out of a voicing so another instrumentalist, such as a bassist, can play it. This can prevent a redundancy in chord factors, namely the root, and can also free up the bassist to not feel restricted in his or her playing. In jazz, for example, playing the root of the chord in the lowest register of the piano or guitar forces the bassist to have to play the root along with the pianist or guitarist, since close intervals in the lower register tend to sound muddy and clash. It also prevents the bassist from playing a different note than the root so he can initiate a chord substitution, which will be covered in more detail in a later episode. For example, if a C major triad is played, a bassist can either play a C or an A. This effectively changes the chord from C major to A minor 7th. Listen to how different these sound. In popular music styles, the piano or guitar doubling the bass voice is usually not a concern since the bass is expected to play the roots with little variation. 2. Each chord factor in a chord can be transposed up or down an octave. Again, this is called octave displacement. 3. Using the same chord factor in more than one octave is possible. When this happens, the chord factor is said to be doubled. 4. In jazz and some forms of popular music, chord factors can also sometimes be omitted. As mentioned earlier, this often happens when a bassist is already playing the root of the chord, and including the root of the chord in the piano or guitar chord voicing may sound redundant. Omitting chord factors is also occasionally true with seventh chords, where the fifth may be omitted since the third and the seventh primarily identify the general characteristics and sound of the chord. When this happens, it is customary to indicate the specific voicing in the chord symbol with either a no 5 or omit 5 as is demonstrated here. 5. The lower middle register of the piano is the fullest sounding, while the higher register tends to sound thin, and the lower register tends to sound muddy or unclear. This was covered in episode 5. Number 6. Voicings intended for solo performance, like a solo piano, often have the root of the chord as the lowest note, or in other words, in root position. Seven. When creating a chord voicing utilizing the lower register of the piano, the following are some general characteristics. A root and octave often sounds the most pleasant in the lower register, followed by a root with a fifth above it, and finally a root and third. Seventh chords often have either a third or seventh as the next highest note above the root. This section lists some common voicings for all the triads and seventh chords. This list is by no means comprehensive, so experimentation on your part is encouraged. The correct fingerings for each voicing can be found at the left of each chord. The notes in the bass clef are to be played by the left hand, while the notes in the treble clef are to be played by the right hand. Incidentally, many of these voicings lay well on the guitar. Let's start with the major triads. Here's one kind of voicing in all the keys. Here's a second kind of voicing for the major triads. Here's voicing number three for the major triads in all the keys. Here is one type of voicing for the minor triads in all keys. Here's a second type of voicing for the minor triads. This example demonstrates a third type of voicing for minor triads. The following is one type of voicing for the diminished triads. This example illustrates a second type of voicing for the diminished triads. Finally, a third type of voicing for the diminished triads. Here are three different kinds of voicings for the augmented triads, starting with this first voicing. Here's a second voicing for the augmented triads. Finally, here's a third type of voicing for the augmented triads. This is one of three typical kinds of voicings for the major seventh chords. Here's voicing number one. Here's a second type of voicing for major seventh chords. Here's the third example of many possible types of voicings for the major seventh chords. These next examples illustrate three of many possible voicings of the dominant seventh chord. Here's a second kind of voicing for the dominant seventh chords in all keys. Here's a third kind of voicing for a dominant seventh chord. Here's three of many possible types of voicings for the minor seventh chord. Here's a second type of voicing for the minor seventh chord in all keys. Finally, a third perspective voicing for a minor seventh chord. Here's three of many possible voicings for a half diminished seventh chord. Here's voicing number one. Here's voicing number two. And voicing number 3. The fully diminished seventh chord has many possible voicings. Voicing 1 is a possible voicing. Voicing 2 of the fully diminished seventh chord is yet another possibility out of many. Here's yet another voicing. The next 3 examples are 3 of many different ways of voicing the augmented seventh chord. Another voicing for the augmented seventh chords. And a third voicing for the augmented seventh chord. Here's 3 of many possible voicings for the minor major seventh chords. We'll begin with voicing number 1. Voicing 2 of the minor major seventh chords. And finally, voicing number 3. Hey, thanks for watching the video. Be sure to like and leave a comment below if you have any questions. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. If you like the music you've been listening to, please be sure to check out Charles Billingsley's album, It's Christmas Time Again, at this link. All the little hellcats jump for joy. So cool it, Rudy, cool it. With your nose aglow. Tell those groovy reindeer. Santa's house to blow. Go, go, go. Dig that crazy Santa Claus. Well, I